doing well. Zach, it's always good to see you. And cool. Well, I'm going to pray. You guys ready for the word tonight?
Yeah.
Father, thank you so much for every person under the sound of my voice. I count it such an honor and privilege to be able to preach your word, to be able to just teach the word of God. Like, I pray, Lord, that we would all hear tonight, that we would be able to get results, that we would be fruitful and multiply. God, let your spirit just rest on this room right now. I pray. In Jesus' name, Lord, give us an understanding heart. Amen. Okay, so we're in this series right now called Back to the Basics, and it's really glad, I'm just pumped to see everyone here tonight. Who here has experienced a significant breakthrough this year in their spiritual walk? A couple of us. Okay. Who here feels like, you know what, I'm more in love with Jesus today than the day I first met him? Don't put up your hand just because it's the spiritual thing to do. Put up your hand because you mean it. Who here honestly feels I'm more in love with Jesus right now than when I first met him? That's awesome. Who here just could use a boost tonight? Okay, good. It's almost all of us. And so, before I even start, I need to just reiterate the foundation. We I really felt about 2 weeks ago that we were just going to have a new kind of momentum and a new launch as a church, and that the Lord wanted to start that off with just talking about some foundations and some basics. And there's a lot of foundations, a lot of basics. One thing I've heard in the last while, believers talk to me about, and even some people in the church, are just, the only answer I ever hear is that reading my Bible and praying is the way that I get breakthrough. Well, guess what? Reading your Bible and praying is the way that you get breakthrough. And it's always been the way that you get breakthrough. Hearing the voice of God is the way that you go from faith to faith. Whatever situation you're facing right now, you are one word of God away from breakthrough. Because he has all the answers. Amen? Okay, who here is like, just has to wake up? Yeah, everyone stand up for a minute. Now, we are not supposed to do this in church. But just shake yourself around, shake your whatever. Okay, now sit down. All right, thank you, Lord. Wake yourself up, grab a pen, grab your notebook or the back of the basics. Notes on the bottom, on the back of your card, of your worship guide, and let's get right into this. We laid a foundation the first week where we just talked about being in Christ, and the second week we talked about Christ being in you, which is the foundation of our faith. There is the gospel that we preach, the gospel of Christ. It's a gospel of freedom. It's a gospel of grace. In other words, Jesus died on the cross so that you and I can come freely and receive forgiveness and come into God's presence without having to do a thing. Amen? Are you guys with me? Jesus said, when he died on the cross, he said, "It is finished." He has accomplished everything that we need to be saved. We don't have to do anything. It's a gospel of grace. The kindness of God, God's goodness, God's love sent Jesus to the cross, and he died on the cross, and then when we come into Christ, it's totally, completely done. We are saved by the blood of Jesus and by his blood alone. There's nothing left to do to inherit salvation. It's already done. We step in by a choice of saying yes to him. I need to talk about this week. I got a plow. Who would say plow?
Wow.
Fast, okay? So the day, the way, and the reward. The Lord just really laid this message on my heart. And the day, the way, and the reward. Hebrews, and it's not on the, we'll go to the next slide in a minute, but Hebrews chapter 6, verse 1 says this. This is a great chapter to meditate on, a great book to meditate on. It says, "Therefore, let us leave the elementary doctrine of Christ and go on to maturity, not laying again a foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, of instruction about baptisms, the laying on of hands, the resurrection of the dead, and eternal judgment. And this we will do if God permits. Now, we are not going to leave the elementary teachings of Christ tonight. We are focusing in on the elementary teachings of Christ. So that's the title of this message, Back to the Basics. And we're going to focus on the day, the way, and the reward. So let's go to the first slide. I'm basically going to read a whole lot of scripture tonight, and I'm going to preach three sermons in 20 minutes. So let's go. 1 Thessalonians, now that's probably not going to happen, but I'm going to try. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13 says this. Verse 13 to chapter 5, verse 11. It says, "But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve." Now, asleep means dead. Everyone say dead. Christians that are in Christ, and then they die. Paul says, we don't want you to be uninformed. "That you may not grieve as others do who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so, through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. For this we declare to you by a word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself would descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will always be with the Lord." That's good news.
Yeah.
You know what that means? It means Jesus Christ is coming again. He's going to come to this earth at the sound of an archangel. And I don't know what that's going to sound like. It's not going to sound like any trumpet we've ever heard before. It's going to be loud. It's going to be so loud, every person is going to hear it, and it's going to wake the dead. The dead in Christ will rise first, and then we're all going to be caught up in the air with the Lord. Jesus is coming again.
Yeah.
Amen. Yeah. Isn't that good news? Yeah. That's awesome. This is the hope that we have. "And thus we will always be with the Lord. Therefore encourage one another with these words." That's what I'm doing as a faithful preacher of God's word. I want to encourage you with a message that the day of the Lord is at hand. Jesus is coming again. "And thus we will always be with the Lord." Now, some Christians believe we're going to float off into heaven, and you know, and the whole earth is going to go through this tribulation. I don't know about that. I don't know. I don't necessarily not believe that. To tell you the truth, at this point in my life, I don't know and I don't care. I don't care. It's going to happen. And whether we float up into the sky or go up into the sky with the Lord, come back down and rule and reign with him, or whether we go to a new heavens and a new earth, there's a whole bunch of different people that think different things and it divides them. My job isn't to, you know, expound on, what's that word, eschatology, which means the end time doctrines and all this stuff. I don't really know about it all. I just know that he's coming again.
Yeah,
yeah. And we're going to rule and reign with him.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
This is good news.
Yeah,
the day of the Lord is at hand. And so let's keep reading for a moment. Now, in the Bible, the Bible wasn't originally written with chapters and verses. It was written as one letter. Theologians and people put in chapters and verses. So I'm just going to keep reading some continued thoughts of Paul. "Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers, you have no need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves are fully aware that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night, while people are saying there is peace and security. Then suddenly destruction will come upon them as labor pains come upon a pregnant woman." Everyone say, ouch. Ouch. Now thank God I never have to experience that. Bless all you who do. "But you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief." So in other words, those who are living for Christ, it's not going to be like a thief, because we're expecting that day. When that day comes, it's not going to come as a surprise, unless you're a sleepy Christian, then it might. But if you're awake in your faith and you're living for God, it's going to come and you're going to be like, woohoo, it's here. It'll be an awesome day because you're expecting it.
Yeah.
"But for you are not in darkness, brothers, for that day to surprise you like a thief, for you are all children of light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober." Keep awake and be sober. "For those who sleep, sleep at night. Those who get drunk at night. And since we belong to the day, let us be sober, having put on the breastplate of faith and love. Everyone say faith and love. For a helmet, the hope of salvation. Most three important things that we can keep really close to us are faith and hope and love. Most powerful things. We need to do a series sometimes on faith, hope, and love. And expound on that. It's so powerful. Hope and salvation. Verse 9, for God has not destined us to wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we might live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build one another up, just as you are doing. So the first part of this message is to simply say this. The day of the Lord is coming. And the archangel is going to come and is going to go, I don't know, it's not going to sound like that. It's going to, I don't know what it's going to sound like, but he's going to blow some kind of massive heavenly trumpet. And the Lord, no, it's not going to sound like that either. And the Lord is going to come, and we're going to see him. And the Bible says that those who are in Christ, who sleep in Christ, who are dead in Christ, are going to rise from the dead. Now, you know, it's not going to be like these zombie corpses walking around like, you know. The Bible says God's going to give every believer a new body. Now, some of them are going to be, they're going to rise up from the earth, a new body. And then those of us who are alive, the Bible says, in another place, as in the twinkling of an eye, we're going to be changed. Just all of a sudden, changed. And we're going to fly up to heaven. We're going to meet the Lord in the air. Now, it doesn't specify again whether we're going to go off into a new heavens or a new earth, or whether we're going to come back down to this one and the Lord's going to renew this earth. I don't know. And I don't care. What I do know is that the day of the Lord is at hand, and Jesus is coming again. Yeah. And what an awesome day that's going to be. Amen? Yeah. That's a foundation of our faith. It is a tenet of what we believe, that God is coming again to redeem his people, and it's going to be an awesome, awesome day. I want to talk about the way. Go to the next scripture. 2 Thessalonians, this is another letter that Paul wrote to the same city, in the same church in the same city, to the people of Thessalonica. Said that right? This is the evidence. This is chapter 1, verse 5. This is the evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you are also suffering. Everyone say suffering.
Suffering.
Yeah? For which you are suffering. Since indeed God considers it just to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to grant relief to you who are afflicted as well as to us when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels. So Paul, what's Paul talking about? He's talking about the same thing he was just talking about. The day of the Lord. Jesus coming again. And the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. And before you go on, I want to talk about that for a moment. There are a lot of rebellious people on the earth. That they have heard the calling of God, they've heard the voice of God, and yet they continually say, "No, thank you, Jesus, for dying for me, but I'm not going to receive you. I don't want anything to do with you." That's a choice that God has given every individual. You're not a robot. He hasn't preordained you to make a certain decision, I don't believe. I believe that, you know, he has an ordained calling for you. He has a predestination that he wants for your life, but he's not going to force anybody to make that decision. So people say, well, if God is so good, how can he send people to hell? Well, the reality is he sends no one to hell. People send themselves to hell. Just as the reality is that you cannot bring darkness into light. Can you bring darkness into light? Everyone say no. No, you cannot bring darkness into light. Darkness will cease to exist in light. Neither can you bring a dark soul into the brilliance of God's kingdom. It cannot exist in the kingdom. So Jesus had to come and pay the price and give us a new nature so that we would have a nature of God, a spirit that is full of light. That's why when you receive Christ, your spirit is all of a sudden transformed and you receive a new nature. You're born again into the kingdom of God. You receive a new nature and all of a sudden you're like, man, I want to do good. I want to be perfect. And you look at that sin and it's like, man, I kind of want to sin. Parts of me want to sin, but I don't want to sin. But I do, but I don't. But I do, but I don't. You're like, ah, you feel crazy. And all of a sudden it's like, why am I going crazy? I want to sin, but I don't, and this is crazy. That's why you feel crazy as a Christian, because you have the new nature, but you have old behaviors and patterns and mindsets that need to be changed. Amen? Okay? As a Christian, you are still probably pretty screwed up. You're like, did you just say that? I did. And you know it, and I know it, so just admit it. Cray cray, I don't know what the heck that means. Oh. But think about it. Think about how messed up you are. But yet in your heart, if you're truly following Christ and if you've been born again, you want to do right. Amen? It hurts you when you sin. And so this is why God says, you know, in Romans chapter 12, it says, renew your mind. Don't be like the world and don't think like the world, but be changed, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So the biggest way, we talk about this a lot, but the biggest way that we get better is we just yield to God's Spirit. We let Him transform our minds so that we can nail more of what He wants us to nail. We can hit more of what He wants us to hit. And that journey is called faith. Let's read on. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord. He's talking about those who do not obey the gospel. Away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of His might. When He comes on that day to be glorified in His saints and to be marveled at among all who have believed. Because our testimony was to you who believed. To this end, we will always pray for you that our God may make you worthy of His calling and may fulfill every resolve for good and every work of faith by His powers. Everyone say this. Every work of faith. Say that with some people are like, my neighbor watching me, I feel embarrassed. Stop it! I'm the one up here making a fool of myself. At least you can say is every work, say this, every work of faith. So Paul's like, the day of the Lord is at hand, but here is my prayer for you. That you would fulfill every work of faith by His power, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in Him, according to the grace of our, everyone say grace. That faith is always by the grace of our God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Paul prays, even though the Lord's coming back, don't just wait in a corner for Jesus to come back. You know, there's a lot of Christians that it's like, woohoo, Jesus is coming back. I'm just going to live my life and praise God. He's going to come. And you can do that, but that's not what Paul wanted. And Paul was God's instrument, so we know that that's not what God wants. He doesn't want you just to hang out, you know, hide in the corner from the evil world until Jesus comes back. He wants you to rise up. He wants you to trust in His grace and start to perform works of faith. I want to talk about for a few minutes the way of God is the way of faith. Faith is the answer to every problem you have, every circumstance that you need changed in your life. You need faith. I need faith. We're going to talk about what faith is for a moment. Go to the next slide. This is a psalm that I memorized as a young person. I don't know if I still have it memorized. I probably do in the New King James Version. We're reading out of the English Standard Version tonight. Psalm 1. It says, blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, or stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of scoffers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law he meditates day and night. He shall be like a tree planted by rivers of water, sorry, that's the New King James Version, by streams of water, that yield its fruit in its seasons, and its leaf does not wither, and all that he does, he prospers. And I've taught before that, go back for a sec, you can actually prosper, go back for a sec, you can actually prosper on purpose. As you meditate in God's word, you will prosper. God's promise to you is, meditate in my word day and night. And then you're going to be like a tree planted by rivers of water. And whatever you do will prosper. And I'm going to keep preaching this word until the day that I meet Jesus face to face. Because I see so many believers that come up to me and they're like, my life is all screwed up. Help me. And I'm like, and I just ask them this, I'm like, have you been reading your Bible? No. It doesn't fail. Because if your breakthrough, I can't take out my fairy God pastor wand and be like, oh, precious child, let me help you. Ding, and you know, just put some fairy God pastor dust all over you and help your problem. I don't have a magic fairy pastor wand, and I don't have any dust, and I can't help you. All I can do is like, God has an answer for you. He really does. And the majority of us, he's saying, I want to talk to you. Because what we don't, we if we go through our lives and just not pay attention to what he's saying to us, I'm like, I know this is probably God, but I'm going to walk the other way. And then all of a sudden we walk this way, the way that he told us not to. And we're like, you know, you come back to me, or you come back to church, or you come back to your cell leader full of holes because the enemy's just been beating you up. And you're like, help me. I'm like, God has an answer for you. I don't have a pastor wand. And I can't wave it over you because, I can't hop in your skin and live your life for you. Only you can live your life. And that life is by faith. And so there's many believers that are being destroyed in their personal faith, yet they're saved by the grace of God. Because faith is, let's keep going. Therefore, the wicked will not stand the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. Okay? I meditated on this a lot, and look at that. The Lord knows the way of the righteous. Now, the way, I'm not talking about the way that you're going. I'm talking about the way that he wants you to go. He knows the way of righteousness. And if you walk on that way, which is the way of the righteous, he's constantly looking over you, guarding every step that you take. But the moment that you get off of his way and you walk in the way of sinners, do you know there's believers, there's Christians, people saved by the grace of God who walk in the way of sinners? You and I do it all the time, don't we? And don't we reap the consequences of it? So one of my goals in life, Lord, help me not to sin more and more, because just because I'm a Christian, I still reap the consequences of my sin. And it hurts. I don't want to do it. Amen. You guys with me?
Yeah.
The Lord knows the way of the righteous. That's the way of faith. Okay, we got to go. The way of faith. Sorry, the way is faith. The way of the righteous is the way of faith. And faith is a verb. And I want to prove this to you, not an adjective. In other words, faith is an action word. Not a descriptive form, but this is a person of faith. If you're a person of faith, you're a person who is moving. The way is a road, it's a path, it's a highway, it's a destination. Let's go on. Hebrews 11, I gotta plow through this, read the whole thing. You guys ready? You're gonna love this. Check this out, you're gonna see it in a way you've never seen it before. Now, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the convictions of things not seen. I want you to look at faith, as we read this, as a verb. Okay, faith, everyone say, a verb.
A verb.
It's an action word, okay? You have to say that. It's an action word. Faith implies action, okay? Verse 2, for by it the people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things that are visible. Look at that verse 1 again. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Now look at all these examples that God starts giving. Check this out. By faith, Abel offered. Okay? Offered is an action.
Yeah.
Yep. By faith, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice. This is Genesis chapter 4. than Cain, through which he was commended as righteous. God commended him by accepting his gifts, and through his faith, though he died, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up. Now it's a little bit different. God did that, but Enoch, I don't know if he had a choice or not, but anyway, he was taken up. That's an action. So that he should not see death, and he was not found because God had taken him. And before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God. And without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists, and that he is a rewarder of those, that he rewards those who seek him.
Yep.
Another verse that says, he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Yeah. Who here likes rewards? Yeah. I love rewards. We're going to talk about that in a minute. By faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear, constructed an ark. Okay? By faith, this great man of Noah, by faith, he didn't just sit there and twiddle his thumbs.
Yeah.
Like many of us. He constructed an ark. He did what God was telling him to do.
Yeah.
A great theologian by the name of Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who lived in the time of World War II, is from Germany. He said this in his book, The Cost of Discipleship. He makes this claim. He says, faith is obedience, and obedience is faith. They're the exact same subject matter. And obedience involves action. So we come into the kingdom of God by receiving his grace, but then we go as far as we want into the kingdom, as far as we want into our authority, by faith or by action or by whatever God tells us to do. We're all on a journey of faith, right? Okay, let's keep reading for a moment. Constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this, he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness that comes by faith. Next slide. Oh, you got it. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go. Okay? You guys just read the story in Genesis chapter 12. Abraham obeyed God when he was called to go to a place that he was to receive an inheritance. Then, and he went out, not knowing where he was going. By faith, he went to live in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised.
Yeah.
My God. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born descendants. Oh, by the way, Abraham was 99 years old, and Sarah was 90 when Sarah got pregnant. And God told the word to Abraham 1 year before. I'm sorry, Abraham was 100 when he got pregnant. He got the promise again when he was 99. And Sarah heard the angel tell Abraham, and she laughed. But she must have reconsidered and took some faith after that. And said, you know what, God, you're faithful who promise.
Yep.
And I'm going to receive power to conceive at the age of 90.
Yeah.
She actually says in the Bible, shall I again have pleasure from my Lord? I'll let you figure that one out. And her Lord was Abraham. All right. Moving along. I'm just preaching the Bible. Where are we? We're born descended stars as heaven, as many as innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. These all died in faith, not having received the promises, but having seen them and greeted them from afar, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. In other words, we're living for the day when Jesus comes again. We're not living for stuff on this earth now. We're living for the reward, which we're going to talk about in a minute. For people who speak thus, verse 15, for they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out. For if they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. Next slide. But as it is, they desired a better country, that is, a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them, By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac. And when he had received the promises, and he who had received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom he said, though through Isaac your offspring be named, he considered that God was able even to raise him from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. By faith, Isaac invoked future blessings on because they saw that the child was beautiful, and they were not afraid of the king's edict, whatever. Verse 24, by faith Moses, when he was grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God. This is by faith. By faith, Moses made a quality decision and said, I could grow up in this palace and reject who I am, or I could run from this place and choose rather. Where are we? Choosing rather to be mistreated with the people of God than enjoy the fleeting pleasures of sin. This is powerful stuff. This right here could be the marking decision of whether or not you walk in the calling God has for you. Because sin is fun. It's like, I'm too holy. No, it's not. The Bible says the sin is it's passing pleasure. It's pleasure that is here one moment and gone the next. But Moses, he considered the reproach of Christ greater wealth than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward.
Yeah.
He left by faith. He left Egypt, not being afraid of the anger of the king, for he endured as seeing him who was invisible. By faith, he kept the Passover and sprinkled the blood. You got to read the story, just Exodus, the whole way through, really, chapter 1 to 15 at this point. By faith, by the blood, so that the destroyer of the firstborn might not touch them. Keep going. By faith, the people crossed the Red Sea as on dry land, but the Egyptians, when they attempted to do the same, were drowned. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they had been encircled for 7 days. One of the craziest stories in the Bible. Can't have time to get into it. These guys, God's like, how? The children of Israel are like, how are we going to conquer this fortified city with huge walls? God's like, hey, kids, just grab some trumpets, get your worship leaders, and circle the land, circle the thing 7 times in 7 days, and at the end of 7 days, yell, ah! And the walls will come tumbling down. And they did. And it was crazy. God is a rewarder of those who seek him. And he'll give you the victory when you obey him. Again, there's a lot of saved Christians. They love Jesus, but they don't have victory in their life. It's because they think faith is some kind of mysterious kind of, ooh, faith is like out here, and it's like not this tangible thing now. Faith is just whatever God's speaking to you right now, you doing it is faith.
Yeah.
And when you do it, you get results.
Yeah.
And when you get results, you're like, I'm a freaking man. Or woman. You get excited, and your Christianity and your walk with God takes on life, and power, and virtue, and purpose, and destiny, and you start to be as crazy as me.
Yeah. Come on.
Oh, no.
Mark's just playing. Mark looks up to me, actually.
I do.
I look up to him, too. You guys tracking with me?
Yeah.
The walk of faith. Faith brings you into victory. Grace covers your sin so that you can walk with God. Where are we? Circle this. Verse 31. By faith, Rahab, the prostitute, did not perish with those who were disobedient because she had given a friendly welcome to the spies. He was talking about, we're in Joshua right now. Paul's like, or the writer of Hebrews is like, man, I can't even talk about all the other guys. I don't have time. So he says, and what more shall we say for that? For time would fail to tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, and David, and Samuel, and all the prophets. All these men, boom, who through faith, look at this, through faith. Everyone say, through faith.
Through faith.
Look at what they did. They conquered kingdoms, enforced justice, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, were made strong out of weakness. Some of you guys are feeling weak right now, and God wants to make you strong.
Yep. Yep. Yep.
By faith, by obedience, your strength, your power is one word from God, and maybe one action away from you taking on another measure of strength, taking on another measure of power, taking on another measure of destiny. What's God calling you to do? He's calling you. He's speaking to you right now.
Yep.
Are you listening to his voice? We obtain the promises of God by faith.
Yeah.
By obeying his voice.
Yeah. Come on.
That's some good preaching right there.
Yeah.
By the edge of the sword, escape the edge of the sword. We're made strong out of weakness. Yeah. Became mighty in war. Put foreign armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection.
Yeah.
I don't know whether to bless you. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release. You know, there's stories all over the world. I remember reading one from the book Jesus Freaks. And in a foreign land, this one pastor was taken hostage, and they wanted him to give up the details of where the hidden church was, the underground church. And he wouldn't do it. And so he was forced to in a cell. And he was at the back of the cell. He didn't eat or drink or sleep for 2 weeks while starving rats were driven into his cell. He had to fend off these starving rats. Couldn't even sleep, because the rats would just attack him. And at last they brought his son into this jail cell. And they started torturing his son before him. And he said, whatever the son's name, he said, son, I've got to tell them I can't bear your torture. And the son looked at him and said, father, don't do me the dishonor, don't do me the disgrace of having a traitor as a father. If I die, I will die with Jesus and my motherland on my lips. They took him and they just killed his son before him. What would cause people to do that? They were more in love with Jesus and more looking forward to their reward than they were to this life. And they just would give up their life. Look at this. It's happened so many times. It's happening right now all over the world. People are being martyred for Christ. Many, many stories, taking pastors by the dozens. Communists in China urinating in a trough, filling the trough with urine and then drowning them in urine. Torturing them. The things people are going through all over the world right now for the name of Christ. Now, what would cause them to act this way? By faith. Some were tortured, refusing to accept release so that they might rise to a better life or a better reward. Others suffered mocking and flogging and even chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were killed with a sword. They went about in skins of sheep and goats, destitute, afflicted, mistreated, of whom the world was not worthy, wandering about in deserts and mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. What people choose to go through for the name of Jesus Christ is beyond this pastor. I've gone through a little bit. You know, the Bible talks about how faith increases in our life. In James 1 verse 2, it says, count it all joy, brethren, when you suffer various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance have its perfect work, that you may be mature and complete, lacking nothing. The way of God is the way of faith. Now, I'm not saying that you're going to suffer some kind of, you know, we live in Canada. One thing we're suffering right now, I'm trying to find a building on Sundays, and there's one little line in the Board of Education, just of Lambton County in Kent District, that says we will rent to, you know, there's myriads of other places, we'll rent all the high school and all the schools in Lambton County and Kent Districts, Chatham. But we won't rent to worship services. It's not the law, it's just Chatham Kent. There's all over Ontario there people are having church and schools. Just five guys decided, and I actually sent the letter to the mayor, and I sent it to Bob Bailey, and the mayor's a little bit jacked about it. He sent me back, he said, we're gonna get to the bottom of this, Josh.
Yeah.
You know? So that's just it. We suffer persecution too. We live in this land called Canada, this land of freedom, because our nation was built on a lot of principles of God's word.
Yeah.
So there's a spirit of freedom in our land.
Yeah.
You try going to some other countries where that spirit of freedom doesn't exist. You lift up the name of Jesus, they'll kill you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Put that in your pipe and smoke it. We're in a holy war. It's the battle of faith.
Yeah.
It's the good fight of faith. You're in a fight. I'm in a fight. We're fighting to obey the voice of God in our lives. Because we know that although there's going to be consequences, there's going to be reward. And we look to that reward, and we value that reward in heaven more than we value anything we could possibly go through on this earth. You read through the New Testament, you see the line of what I just said over, and the truth of what I just spoke over and over and over and over and over and over and over. From Jesus' teachings to Paul's teachings, okay, we got it. And all these, though commended through their faith, did not receive what was promised, and God had provided something better for us. Apart from us, they should not be made perfect. I gotta say this again. The way is the way of faith, and faith leads to the reward. Gotta close up on this. Go to the next scripture. 1 Corinthians 3, I want to read this. This is the last scripture. I know we've read a lot. Your brains are probably on overload right now. Let's read six more verses. You ready? According to the grace of God given me, Paul saying to the Corinthian people, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation, and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care how he built on it. You know what? This is a word for every single one of us here tonight. Now for me, I'm a novice builder. I'm not like the Apostle Paul at the age of 50 or 60 right now, who's been building the church for, 30 years of his life. For me, I don't know a whole lot. I'm a novice builder, but I've laid the foundation of Dunamis Church is Jesus Christ. Believe you me, it is the Lord. As crazy as we are, as untraditional as we are, our Orthodox faith is founded on this word, and this church was started because God spoke to this man and said, "I want you to start a church." I always thought I was going to be a youth pastor. And the Lord said to me, I want you to start a church. And Pastor Brennan's going to be your pastor and laid out the foundation for me. And so we did. And each of us, you all have an opportunity to build on it. You can build on this church. That's why it's powerful to bring someone to this church so that they can hear the Bible being preached. There's momentum. It's more powerful when we're doing it together as a body than when it's just a couple of guys doing it. There's 50 people in this room right now, at least. What would happen if you all started building the church on purpose? Yeah. But how do you build? Come on, we just talked about it for 25 minutes. Hey. By faith. You build by faith. Yeah. Whatever God, Jesus is telling you to do. Verse 11, for no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on the foundation with gold, silver, and Paul's giving an analogy, gold, silver, or precious stones, wood, hay, straw, each one's work will become manifest, for the day will reveal it. Capital D, the day is the day of the Lord. Amen? Yeah. We're tying this message together. We're saying the day of Christ's return will reveal how each believer has built on the church, according to their faith, their gifting, their ability, what God has put in them, the day will reveal it. Because it will be revealed by fire. Remember, the Lord comes in fire? Remember that we just read in 2 Thessalonians? You guys with me? The day will reveal it. It will be revealed by fire what kind of work each one has done. And the fire will test what sort of work each one has done. If the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, but only as through fire. In other words, there's some of us dawdling around in our Christian walk, not building much, or if what we're building something, it's not really building according to faith. The Word of God says an amazing statement in Romans chapter 13. It says, whatever is not of faith is sin. And what does that mean? That means whatever we do contrary to the will of God is actually missing the mark. It's sin. But whatever we do in the will of God is faith. Yeah. I proposed to Carly by faith. Okay? Oh yeah. Jesus spoke to me. I woke up Thursday morning and God was like, today's the day, son. And I'm like, really? He didn't say it like that. Like, he did, but in his voice. That was like my voice. It didn't sound like, today's the day, my son. No. He said, he spoke to me by faith. Kayla, right? Michaela, 2 weeks ago, was walking by River City and felt an urge to come in. Gave her life to Christ, got baptized the same night. Woo! By faith! You guys are here right now, sitting under the preaching of God's word, by faith. You're already on the journey. So take what you're learning and say, God, I want to build with gold and silver and precious stones. Help me not to build with wooden hay and straw, because guess what? Fire burns up wooden hay and straw, but it doesn't burn up gold and silver and precious stones, does it? We want to build this church on faith, on what God is speaking to us. We got to get back to this. It's got to be more than a preach tonight. I pray that it would get inside of your hearts.
Yeah.
And that we would begin to build like never before. It takes faith to come to morning prayer and pray. We meet Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. till 9 a.m. every morning down there. Some of you guys don't come because you don't think it's worth anything. You haven't caught the revelation that those who seek God in prayer will receive answers, and there's power released, and there's, when you start agreeing and speaking God's word, you're the authority on God's, of God's voice on this earth, and when you pray and declare things, they happen.
Right.
Amen. Amen? So we pray, and we declare things, and God's moving in this city.
Yeah.
I invite you to come Monday to Friday, 8 a.m. to 9 a.m., and start praying with us, right down in the main office space. I'm trying to make it every day. I'm getting better. I made it 3 days this week. Bless God. I'm doing better. You don't have to clap for me. That wasn't that good. I'm doing better. I made a bet with John that I'd be able to wake up at 5 a.m. for 50 days straight. I made it 5. I gave him $100 yesterday. It sucked. I was going to say double or nothing, but I'm like, I don't think I can do this. I need to go to bed at 10 if I want to get up at 5, and Carly always keeps me up past 10. No, it's not her fault. It's my fault. It's my fault. I can't say no to a pretty face. What can I say? Her pretty face, not just anybody. I can say no to any other face but that. It's called brownie points. Brownie points. We're going to end here. I want to invite you guys into, you know, your life can, this, I'm not preaching on salvation right now, I'm preaching on your reward. The day, the way, and the reward. They're all connected. God doesn't want us to wait for the day. He wants us to rise up and live in the way so we can obtain the reward, the full reward that he has for us. I'm telling you, the reward that God has for you in heaven is an eternal reward. And it's better than any pleasure, anything that we can have on this earth.
Yep.
And, amen. We're saved by grace.
Yep.
But we obtain a reward by faith through grace. It's all grace, but we get to decide. How much do you want? Guys, just look this way. However big and influential this church gets is not just up to my preaching. It's up to your listening and your doing. Because the Word of God says that be a hearer of the Word, but be a doer of the Word also. Don't just hear the Word and not be a doer and deceive yourself. So, this word is going to change you tonight. If you do it, you'll become more faithful, more full of faith. And if you let it just slip by and say, oh, good preaching. You got excited. I think I felt a spittle on me. thanks for another meeting. But really, this is up to each one of us to rise up and to walk this walk of faith. No matter how broken you are right now, no matter how much you've suffered, God wants to heal you, and He has a way. He has a way. It's available right before you today. Isn't that good? We have an amazing dad, an amazing father. He doesn't just let us drown, but He sent His Son Jesus. And I look around this room right now, and I know every face in this room. And I know that there's nobody here who's not responded to Christ before, except one guy, and I'm assuming that he has. You go to Bible college with her?
Yeah.
Okay, well hopefully you're saved. You go to Bible college.
I'm going to assume you are.
So I'm not going to give an altar call tonight for new Christians, but I am going to give a call to the faith. I make a commitment to Dunamis Church as your pastor to preach my guts out every week with the faith that God gives me. And yeah, I yell, I spit, I preach because I believe in the preaching of God's word. I believe it's powerful. It's the way that the church was started. It's the way that it will grow today through preaching. Let's walk this walk of faith together, guys. Get a new passion for 2012.
Yeah.
Get a new fire for this year.
Yeah.
Cast the old off.
Yeah.
Let's close with this verse and we're going to worship for a moment. I know we went over time. It's all Mark's fault. Just kidding, sort of. We just read Hebrews 12, sorry, Hebrews 11. Let me read two verses from Hebrews 12, verse 1 and 2. It says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and sin which clings so closely, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author, or the founder, and the perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is seated at the right hand of the throne of God. And everything I just read, let's stand up right now. And I want you to shake off, just give to God right now, every weight, whatever you're thinking about right now that's holding you back. I don't know, what will my family think? If I confess to them all that I'm a Christian, that I'm following Christ, don't worry about it, throw it off. They might think you're crazy. The gospel, the Bible says, is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, this word of God is the power of God. Cast off every weight. Throw off the sin that could so easily ensnare you. Just throw it off right now. God, I give this stuff to you. Just give it to him. Forget about the person on your right and left. Just give it to him right now. Give it to him. Give it to him. Lord, I give you my vanity. I don't want to care about what people think about me. I want to care about what you think about me. I give you my quirkiness, God. Thank you for the gift of my individuality and the gift of my personality. The gift of my uniqueness. God made you quirky because he loves you. Embrace it. Leverage your quirkiness. There are so many weird people that need to be reached, and you're going to reach them because you're weird. Embrace it. We are all weird. We're all individual. We're all unique. Embrace the love of Jesus right now. Father, I just ask right now that you would just save every person to the uttermost. You would set this church on fire this year like never before. Help us run this race of faith. Help us do what you're asking us to do. We're saved by your grace, but we run by faith. Let your grace empower your people tonight, Father, I pray. Shh. I just feel in my heart right now. Is there any people here? This may be a step of faith for you, but who need to commit their lives to Christ afresh tonight. God, I need your grace, I need your forgiveness, and I'm choosing you to be the Lord and the Savior of my life. Committing my life to you, not to be perfect. I'm embracing the fact that I'm screwed up, but I'm going to let you unscrew me for the rest of my life. I'm going to let you fix me. I'm going to pursue you, pursue your ways, pursue your heart. Just chuck up your hand right now if that's you. Thank you. Put your hand down. Thank you. Is there anybody else? Thank you.